I'm going to talk a slightly ambitious run through so many things that I've been involved in over the years in urban design. And I begin with, in the introduction, it was described as my having given a talk here. It actually was University of Westminster, which was called the Polytechnic then. And it was the night of an RIBA talk by Richard Rogers. And I think he was getting the gold medal, I'm not sure. But it was on, it was 16th of October 1984, 32 years ago, when Urban Design Group was a campaigning group. And for a long time, even the words and the expression urban design, you had to persuade people or explain to people what you meant. And I felt we got there when I heard Tony Blair, when he was about 2 years into his prime ministership, he said, what we need more is urban design in cities. And I thought, my God, you don't have to explain it to politicians anymore. And I and the campaigning group and the Richard Rogers lecture that night was very much, at that time, what we were opposed to. There was international modernism had a non-contextual, not interested in history, and so on. And wind forward to the end of the 90s, and he led the urban renaissance, and wind forward to now, and there are so many involved here, and it's such a big subject now, and so active is urban design. But it's hard to place your mind back to the fact that it was a campaigning group to raise awareness when there wasn't much awareness. And it's interesting to think about what's been in progress and how, and I'm sure the Urban Design Group and the leaders here continuously think about what has changed, how they handle change. When you're a pioneer, when you're trying to think of what to do, and you're leading on an unknown front, it's very different leading when you've all got followers and you won the argument, but then the floodgates are open and everyone's there. Every firm claims it's an urban designer now. They have master planning, they have, and so on. So how do you cope with that? How do you change and adopt that? And but this project was very much one that, can I point with this? Yes, good. This was the proposal at the time for at Mansion House. And it was a Mies van der Rohe tower and a square in front of it. And I did a proposal for Save an English Heritage, and I appeared at the inquiry. And I presented it that night, 32 years ago, as being what I felt it was all about. And it wasn't a talk on postmodernism. It was about where we were and where we should be going to in urban planning. And this was proclaimed, it's Richard Rogers that rang me up to say, we all must support this because we don't have a Mies tower in London and we need one because it's an icon and he's a great architect. And it was a single object with a square in front of it and did away with streets and so on. And I opposed it by doing an alternative scheme. And I was very interested in trying to compare the component bits. I said, there were, I don't know how many front doors, but there were 200 front doors here. There was only one there. There were only three materials, glass, steel, and concrete. And there were hundreds of materials there. And I was interested in just tabulating what was the underlying quality and describing that quality. And it was about history too. It was about the street pattern, and it was about pedestrians. This was I spent a lot of time thinking about the crossings and and how you connected. And this was totally against the square. I don't know which I objected to most, the tower or the square. The square, I think I objected to more, but it was all part of the idea that you had this single object versus complexity. I went on to do buildings that everyone who's seen the Bond films knows. When I give a talk in China or wherever, Australia or whatever, I start off with this slide because people say, "Ah, that I recognise that because it's in the Bond film." What is not known is the urbanistic background to it. I've always felt that buildings should learn from urban design. And this was a new public park and walkway at the front. And we've since then done a lot of work with Lambeth on the island, the roundabout, and we keep going. And this was the other building of that time, which was part of a planning project for improving the park, making a shared street out of Villiers Street. And you can see the principles here that the urban grain hid the big building behind, and the big building was addressing the river in scale and so on. So there was a whole thing about foothills and palace on the river and deriving the architectural concept from context, which was quite contrary to a lot of what was going on at the time and still goes on, where the object is seen as more important than the context. But I went on to do a lot of master plans. Brindley Place, we master planned, Newcastle Quayside, Camborne, and Edinburgh Exchange, and that was all the 90s. I've been involved in urban design since I studied city planning and architecture at University of Pennsylvania. And I qualified as a planner. And when I go to evenings where there's it's an RIBA event, they describe me as a planner. And when I go to the Town Planning Institute, they describe me as an architect. And it's interesting how those two, and I think designing and planning are very, very difficult to reconcile because they're different mindsets. But I do think urban design has this enormous task of trying to combine the two. I was fascinated at the time when I was a student by Jane Jacobs and Ian McHarg on ecology and Paul Davidoff, who was teaching there and taught me on choice theories of planning and the role of planning enabling civil rights issues and so on. But the thing that really fascinated me about Jane Jacobs is that she wrote wonderfully particularly that cities are has to be seen as problems of organized complexity. And that was one of the very first times that expression was used. And chaos theory and mathematics and science, she was up there in thinking terms with all the world. And I wrote this book, The City is the Tangled Bank, about 3 or 4 years ago. And I took this organized complexity and harked back to Darwin, where I found Darwin's last chapter, last paragraph, utterly extraordinarily inspiring. He described a tangled bank with birds and all the ecology that goes on in balance and so on and harmony, but it doesn't look anything. It looks it's a tangled bank. It's not visually organized as we understand it. But he ends up by saying there is grandeur in this view of life, and I think that's an extraordinary statement about cities. That was another thing I wrote at the time, or before that time. But I think this I'm going to come to Philip Ball in a minute, his statement, but it's about what is the essence of cities and how is it about visual order? Have we got it right when planning and design combine in urban design and plan bits of the city? Or is it happening anyway? And I often used to say to students when I was giving a talk, particularly in the Far East, saying that that we think that cities are made by architects and planners and engineers. They actually contribute quite a small percentage to what actually happens. And the city is made up of non-professionals, probably dominating by as much as 70%. I'm just guessing. And if so, what is the city? And is it worse off for that? Or is it actually as good or better? And I think these are important questions. How much does design and how much does planning contribute to our cities? I'm not saying, therefore, don't bother. I think what I mean by this is that it's important to understand what is the nature of the order that you're trying to come to grips with. When Jane Jacobs was writing about Corbusier, she said that he attempts to do an order that's the wrong order. And she wrote that, I paraphrase, but she wrote something like, the wrong order is worse than anything. It's worse than letting it all hang out, letting it happen by happen chance. So what the real issue is, how do you understand the evolving pattern of cities? How do you get under the DNA of cities and city making that's happening already, whether we like it or not? And I use the analogy in the book Tangled Bank of Termite Man. They've been around for 30 million years, and they're extraordinary pieces of habitat with food growing in them and air conditioning, and they build it themselves, and they build it as a united combined brain. These are sketches I did when I was in the planning and urban design course, and there's a lot of parallels I didn't realize at the time, but I was trying to get sketches of the city to show how the city, I didn't think it was an organism any more than the termite mind is an organism, because it's made of mud and what have you. It's more than an organism. There's a DNA of placemaking that's true for bees, termites, ants, and all creatures that make a habitat. And it's true of mankind. We do have a DNA of habitat. We tend to have squares in the middle of town squares. We have streets. We have iconic buildings. We have town halls. You find even in the most primitive villages in Africa, there's certain things that happen that are integral to the organization of place. And I think we need to think more about what it is, what is the human habitat of place. I use this one, one of many examples. This is what was called the stomach diagram. The tube system of London just grew and grew. There was no plan. And in fact, the Circle Line began as a connection between here at Farringdon and Paddington Station. And then they built another bit somewhere else, and then another bit, and then they realised they were actually making a circle, and that was because they were connecting the mainline stations, and they hadn't quite realised that. And then they connected it all up, and then what was interesting was when they then did a plan for an outer circle line, that failed to happen. Almost as though the premeditated plan was not as successful as the kind of natural plan. And when you look at what happens underground, there was no master plan for this. There kind of was, because people were adapting and converting as they went. But what is the order of this? And how does the subway and tube system work? There's an extraordinary complexity. It's organised complexity, because the Circle Line was a cut and cover. It was under the streets. That was found to be extremely disruptive and probably wouldn't have gone any further. And then Brunel, the father and the son, did the Rotherhithe Tunnel and discovered a way of tunnelling deep down. And that changed the tube system. And the other thing that changed the tube system was a diagram by Harry Beck and others that registered that the tube system needed a mental map. And I'm fascinated by order from mapping. In a manifesto for London, which I did 10 years ago for Architectural Review, I mapped things like, many things, but I mapped gyratories and where they were. But I also mapped London underpasses, the pedestrian underpasses. Now, pedestrian underpasses, every time you stop and ask the layperson or a politician, say, why are there railings here? What are the railings all about? They say they're protecting the pedestrians. They're not. They don't exist in many other cities. They're there because the traffic planners of the 60s, 70s and 80s were prevented from making building big roads that Abercrombie and Buchanan style, and widening Edgware Road and Marylebone Euston Road. In fact, Abercrombie had a plan for an 8-lane limited access highway that demolished the Camden Town, demolished Primrose Hill so that nobody would be objecting to Crossrail because they wouldn't exist. It went through Clifton Road in Maida Vale, bashed through Paddington and so on, and it was access only about every mile distance, and it was 8 lanes wide. That's the way you met the traffic demand. What's happened is the other way around, is that we resisted the traffic demand, which they didn't do in other cities like Newcastle and Liverpool and so on. But they resisted it in London. And what's happened is an extraordinary adaptive and evolutionary approach to traffic. And I and the pedestrian crossings were invented, the Preston railings were invented by those traffic planners who were then urged by the politicians that we then have to manage the traffic somehow. So they were designed to keep the theoretical speeds of the traffic flowing when they met congested areas. And if you look at every one of these, they're at places of maximum pedestrian activity. So if you see a pedestrian underpass, you also see a railing, and you know you're at a place of high connectivity of pedestrians. That's where everybody is trying to and that is completely illogical and quite mad, actually. And of course, we're now pulling down railings, and I've been campaigning for this for years. I took on particularly Park Lane when I was working with the Royal Parks. I looked at Marble Arch and Park Lane and Hyde Park Corner, and we now have crossings there, not only on the gyratories, so-called, but also on Park Lane itself. There are now two reinstated crossings there. And everywhere you see this happening, that people are now looking at one-way systems, making them two-way. I've been campaigning for this and underpasses and get rid of the pedestrian underpasses for a long time. This is the common time. This is a book I wrote on Shaping London. And this is how the how the underground systems grew and how they were depicted. And it's a truthful depiction. This is where the actual tubes are. And the lines in colour were who owned them, because they were all run by different people. And they gradually got bought up, and they gradually all amalgamated. And I was fascinated to read that there was a Baker Street line and there was a Waterloo line that was separately owned and built separately and owned separately, and they became the Bakerloo and so on. And then it was thought there needs to be a common ticketing system and there needs to be a map that combines it all. And it wasn't until you had the map, and I'm fascinated by pattern searching, because it's not until you draw a pattern of this organized complexity do you really see that there's order, in the tangled bank. It may not look order, but there is grandeur in this. And there's grandeur in the tube system. It is phenomenally complicated, but there's ways of describing it so that we all can understand it. And there are maps of the M25. This is an excellent map. The M25 does that, but this is how you understand it. We did a scheme for the inner ring road for the North-South Circular, and we call that the road to renewal, and so on. And it gives rise to so many schemes. This is one of my favourite pictures. Humphrey Repton was in partnership with John Nash. To my mind, John Nash was the greatest architect, urban designer, just about ever anywhere. He was extraordinary. I don't think he meant to be extraordinary, he just was. And he planned so much of London. And he invented, working back from urban planning typologies, he invented architectural typologies. So his palaces in the park were an invention. They were about how you get a palazzo in a park and divide them up into lots of houses. And then the suburban bits, Park Village East and West, he invented suburban houses based upon picturesque traditions or aspirations. He then did Regent Street, which he designed the facade, but the facade always had to be the same to make coherence, but the builders who built them had to build the facade but could do what they like behind. And so you get this extraordinary inventions of John Nash and its relationship of architecture to planning. But what is little known is that he was in partnership in very early on, and he fell out with him. I'm sure there were two strong individuals, with Humphrey Repton. And Repton pioneered, before him was Capability Brown, but he particularly pictorialized the landscape tradition. And I think landscaping informed urban landscape. And he did the Little Red Book. Every time Repton did a scheme for a client, for a great estate owner or in the countryside, he did these drawings, which had flaps. You can just see one of them there. And the flaps came back and showed the before and after. And that's what urban planning is all about. It's about adaptation, conversion. Even the new towns, even Brasilia and Milton Keynes, are now being adapted. Milton Keynes is extraordinary the way it's now facing up to 50 years in existence. Brasilia began to get converted and adapted from the moment it was finished. And I think that if you're a town planner and urban designer, how the skills of adaptation and conversion are absolutely critical for you. And this is the scheme we did for the Nash route, where the Nash Mile went from Primrose Hill and Regent's Park right down to St. James. And Nash designed or laid out all of this, including St. James's Park. He designed the Buckingham Palace, of course. He designed various buildings, laid out St. James's Park and onwards and upwards. And these are all the in dark here are the buildings he actually designed. And what I proposed here was, how do you rationalise that for the modern era? This is a little doodle I did, and I think it's, and it's for me, it's a touchstone of what cities and urban places are all about. If you build individual trees and design, or if you place, and you can imagine in your mind a tree in a landscape, it is a very perfect symmetrical thing. It fulfills its biological DNA purpose. It's a very complete, but it has the problem of wind, it has the problem of exposure and so on. If you get a woodland, the tree that's symmetrical and a perfect shape then becomes adaptive. The trees in the middle reach up for the sky. The trees on the edge are all lopsided. And what the extraordinary discovery is, of course, in a woodland, you get this thick undergrowth and the tangle bank happens beneath them. The tangle bank tends not to happen here. And of course, this is the battle between, the modern battle between architects and planners. Architects want their building invariably to be singular and iconic, and the gherkin, slam down to ground and ignore what goes on around it. I think Nash was a genius because he managed to do the both, and I think he created an urban ecology and a way forward which is a model for us all. Oh, sorry, let me just go back to the Philip Ball statement. He, in his book, The Self-Made Tapestry, which is a wonderful title, he said, it's scarcely surprising since the major preoccupation of urban planners with the design of cities, they have generally attempted to analyze city forms in terms of their own efforts. And then he goes on to say, the trouble is, hardly any cities are like that. In spite of the effort of planners to impose simplistic order, which is a visual order, most large cities present an apparently disordered, irregular scatter of developed space. Urban theories have often ignored the fact that a city grows organically, not through the dictates of planners. And I think that's maybe overstating it, but the planner has to find the role that he's working with forces rather than imposing forces. And I think that's a very profound comment by her. I have a slight bias, and I am an architect, as the introduction said, but I think that architects do often get it wrong. And I've singled out two Maggie Centres that won major awards. This is the Frank Gehry one in Dundee, and it's a wonderful building, and it's a wonderful cause, and I don't knock it, and so on. And this was done with very great care and wonderful, and won awards. Next to it is a huge mess, which is a typical big general hospital. It was built with some kind of order, but it's been added on. The car parks are here, there, everywhere. There is no one applying themselves to think about what is this hospital. And it's almost an inhuman task to plan. So it's better for most architects to say, let's build a little jewel and give it awards all to one side. And that is true also of the Rogers one, which won the Sterling Prize, which I don't knock. It's a wonderful building. It's beautifully done. It's crafted. It's a gem. It's a jewel. But next to it is Charing Cross Hospital, which is an unbelievable mess. Not because anyone wants it to be a mess, it's just too big a problem. And architects don't address, and urban designers and planners don't address what, they don't give awards to somebody that improves it a bit, heroically could improve the operating theatres or the bed spaces by far more ingenuity and so on, but it's not tangible because that has its own bit of order. You can see the, and that is what we do internationally and globally. We see our efforts in those terms, but not in these terms. And I'm fascinated by Google Maps, Google Earth, the way the houses are adjusted. Actually, I'm fascinated by the hospital, the way it's been added onto, the way you can see 1960s bits and 70s bits, and you can almost read the decision-making that's gone on and the ad hocism that goes on. And so I've been I wrote this book about shaping London, where I said the landscape dictates in the first place, and the landscape underwrites almost everything. And then places and streets, particularly the urban infrastructure, the engineering infrastructure, bridges and so on. Then the placemaking happens, and then the architecture. And that's the order in which we ought to see priorities. I think the landscape is a key thing. And so I did this sketch in that book of... I'm a bit of a nerd for Google Earth. I'd love to study it because it's so revealing. Just as I like to stand in the street and look at what people are actually doing, where they cross the road and how do they avoid the railings and what, how are people using this space? Not because there's a brief, but the place as a client. And I looked at this order here. This is Buckingham Palace, of course. This is Parliament Square, and this is Trafalgar Square. And I was fascinated by these three squares. And I thought, is there an order? Is there a tangled bank kind of order that you could say that there's grandeur in all this? And I came up with the conclusion that the British Constitution, people say, is not written down and is not known to anyone because it's too complicated. But actually, if you want to look for the definition of the British Constitution and the order of life, you just look at what's built without any master plan. For example, you have the palace up here, and you have St. James's, which is occupied by some of the royal family. You have the members of the royal family on the Mall here, Clarence House and so on. And you have Kensington Palace, and all the palaces are all together and up there. You have Parliament, which is, in this country we have church and state, so you have Westminster Abbey, and you have House of Parliament and the House of Lords and Commons with a corridor linking the two beside them. And I could go on, but next to it is Westminster School, and the boys, primarily boys, that went to prep school, went then to public school, went on to Oxbridge, went on to the Inns of Court, went on the Houses of Parliament and Westminster. They've never moved out of that environment with open staircases and so on. And this is an extraordinary manifestation of the power and influence at work, and also church and state. But what are the buildings right next to the Parliament? You've got, first of all, the Treasury, and that's the most powerful department. Next of all, the Foreign Office, which used to be. It's not so important now. And the Prime Minister, unlike other countries, is in a little side street and called the Prime Minister. And what is in the middle, interestingly enough, can't do this, can't see it anymore, but what is in the middle, below the monarchy in a straight line, is the Horse Guards, where the Queen comes, because she is our general, or whatever it's called. It's called the. She is in charge of the army, the navy, and so she comes saluting the colour, and she comes down in a straight line in between Parliament Square and the People's Square. And next to it is the War Office, the Admiralty, so they all group round the middle. And then you get Parliament, you get Trafalgar Square, and you get a mixture of things around it. But that out here is the press and the law, the defenders of the people. Out here you've got the defenders of Parliament, the apparatus of security. You get Scotland Yard, you get MI5, you get MI6, and so on. They're all that way. And I think it's fascinating how self-ordering goes on without us having to have a master plan and say anyone saying this is the way you were going to lay out London. Of course, when you go to Washington, it's all laid out deliberately because they're inventing it at one point in time. But Britain, I like Paris, actually. I mean, the Louvre was the King's Palace. But we have a more evolutionary approach. The Tangle Bank is, you need to read it. And one of the things about reading it is diagrams. And this is plans I did. I was fascinated when I went to Hong Kong. There are the same number of people living in each place. But because it's mountainous and it's islands with lots of sea, the people there live on the edge of the land. Whereas in London, they are very spread out. And it's very fascinating just to look at it, to think what this means, that pattern. And then you look at the open spaces. In London, they're incremental and they are very urban, but they're not small, but it's extraordinary how London organises open space. Hong Kong, on the other hand, has vast water space and has these mountains. And when people say to me, Hong Kong is, that must be a very, very dense place. I said, no, Hong Kong is like Scotland, only subtropical. Because you get a 10, 20-minute taxi drive out of the centre of Hong Kong, and you can be in absolute wilderness in next to no time. And it expresses itself in where the population lives. And then you can look at other patterns, because if you live out here in London, and you're in that outer area of London, the number of buses you can get, the transport system is completely different when you live in this kind of urban corridor. And of course, the density here is tremendously high, but the density there is not, but the density overall is probably the same. And you can read cities like that. This is Shanghai, which has got old parts. It's got vast motorways of a scale that's bigger than Hong Kong or anywhere else I know except Beijing. And of course the density. And this is Hong Kong. And it's interesting how entrepreneurial the Hong Kong are and how small pencil sites, families don't sell their land. They build these blocks that are two or three flats at most a floor and shoot them upwards for about 40, 50 stories. And you can read cities, you can read the underlying pattern. And I was fascinated when I was doing buildings there, learning from John Nash, that if you're on the top, you're in area A, and that's a profile against the sky. If you're in building B, which I'll come to in a minute, the consulate, you have a different, you're on mid-levels, and that's a winding road along the contour. If you're on the landfill at the bottom, that's different again. And this is the contour project we did, which is the consulate. And it's a wall. It's a kind of linear snake. And that's how the mid-levels work. And if you're down at the bottom, this is the landfill area. And nothing stays still. We did that project, now built. That last picture was... As an idea, early 90s, this is it built, and we're now doing the project in front, which is the cultural district, and we're working with Herzog's on this very large billboard building. The galleries are on the flat horizontal bit, and the offices above, and the offices will be the biggest. As it were, animated facade anywhere in the world. And this was our plan for where, when we competed with about 10 on the shortlist for this area. And I was fascinated that we weren't shortlisted. Rem Koolhaas, Norman Foster, and one other local architect were shortlisted. But we produced a street. It was very, very different to Hong Kong. It wasn't multi-level, it wasn't complex, and I really liked the ground plane, and I thought this was a sufficient size to respect the ground plane and to have a street. And then the Norman Foster scheme won it 3 years later, and they had had consultations in the meantime, and no doubt our scheme was part of the consultation. But his is one street, and so on. And the lesson, I think, is that, and he made a big thing of learning from streets. He made a big thing of Nathan Road, which is nearby, being his model. The width of it and the animation of it and so on. And I'm fascinated by how urbanism, since the early days of the Urban Design Group, has now converted everybody so that they're now all urbanists. And Norman Foster's first scheme here was one single building, which is like the Mies van der Rohe Tower and the space. Now it's a complex and it's disaggregated, it's on a street base. And of course, Richard Rogers has now argued for the urban renaissance and so on. And it's interesting how much it's all changed and everyone's recognizes urbanism. This is a scheme I did for in China for the for Beijing for the main opera house, and this is not working anymore. Oh, it is. Well, it doesn't show up there. This is Tiananmen Square in the centre, and these are the buildings. And I did an urban design study of how the new proposal of the opera house could be a space enclosure to make space positive. But the opposite theory, which is very much the prevalent one of the opposite argument, which is kind of harking back to the international style and Corbusier in his 20s, 30s mode, is that the opera house should be not space positive, it should be an object. And his scheme was the oval that which you see there. And our scheme was the rectangle, which we felt was slightly further north. He placed his symmetrical, which hides the facade of the Great Hall of the People. We said it should. We made an urban design plan as part of the architecture, which I like to think Nash would be proud of. And this was the winning scheme, the oval, and this was our scheme. Coming back to London, then I have always felt and passionately believe that you should start with place. Louis Kahn used to say, what does your building want to be? Which he was very kind of old world, Old Testament Jewish kind of character. He liked to think in those kind of terms. And I often think about that, and I'm not sure what buildings want to be, but I'm absolutely clear that you can look at cities and places and think, what do they want to be? Clearly, Oxford Street wants to have less buses on it. It's a place that's crying out to be sorted out. You just have to look at it. Never mind reading the papers about how many accidents there are, buses running down people. It's a self-evident thing, and you look at the railings and you realise the railings and the pedestrian paths are places of maximum pedestrian intensity. So you're saying, actually, this is a conflict. You've got to give priority to pedestrians, and so I developed this expression, place of client. So. What does your place want? And I looked at the Royal Parks and Park Lane, and I looked at the palaces, and I looked at the Thames, and I particularly looked at Marylebone Euston Road, which I felt was the best connected street in London. And I looked at improvements along it and so on. And I also looked at the Thames Estuary at that time. The Marylebone Euston Road project was around about 2003, this was 2004 or 5, and I took the government's definition of the space of the Thames Gateway, and I said This is, they want to, the stated aim of Prescott was that, the Deputy Prime Minister, was that he wanted to meet the housing shortage on the Thames gateway lands and provide housing for 200,000 people. We did a study that showed that if you had 200,000 people at his own recommended densities, it would fit into a square that's about that size. It's a small, it's about 5 miles square. And this is, we're talking about a space that's 50 miles long and 20 miles wide at one point and narrowing down to 5 miles wide. It clearly wasn't a housing provision project. It was, if anything, I felt it was a landscape regeneration project. And I felt that we came up with the slogan that landscape is the first infrastructure. And we then got funding, we lobbied the government. And I think it's interesting, this way of doing things, in, not only in this country, but anywhere, that this way of proposing things from the profession, I think is important. I think architects and landscapers and planners and engineers ought to put through, and they are now doing much more so. The best one, I think, that's around at the moment is the idea of a national park city. No mayor, no commissions, no one would run a competition saying, national park city, can you please all submit your credentials for it? Because the idea came from out there, from somebody who's he was a geography teacher, Ray Nelson, and he thought he was studying where school children went and how they use open spaces and so on. And he came to the conclusion that what this needs, is, London needs, is to be a national park city. And the more he looked into it, the more convincing it was. We came up with the idea that the estuary should be made into a national park. He's been much more successful in his PR than we were. Nevertheless, we got the government, first Yvette Cooper and then the Tory government, and this was all introduced by Boris, who inherited it all, actually, but we built a lot of stuff, which 70 million on landscaping can build. And I got involved in Old Oak Common, and I said, this is the best connected place in Europe is Old Oak Common, and everything flows from that. So I said, it's a highly valuable place, and what was planned for it was a depot and sidings, vast sidings. Because the railways own the land, they dumped they dumped all these sidings, the stabling, as they call it, vast acreage, unbelievable acreage of depot and siding for the whole of Crossrail, next to the HS2 station, next to the Crossrail station, next to where it's potentially a Heathrow Express station. In other words, next to where the best connected railway station we were then building could happen. And yet we put all this stuff on it because it was empty at the moment. But actually, clearly, what the place needed was other stuff, people. What it needed, and we've shown, and there are presently plans for 25,000 homes and 25,000 homes and 50,000 jobs there, which is extraordinary because the land is enormous. It was laid out as railway land. And that got me interested in the whole thing of the growth of land of Britain and the increasing population and so on. And we then got interested in the whole airport debate, and we argued that actually where the next runway goes and which airport is expanded is a piece of city making, and yet the equations, the arguments are entirely about air travel and plus business. But it's not about that. It's about which area, and we came up with the belief that it shouldn't be Heathrow, it should be one of the others. It should be Luton, it could be Birmingham, it could be Stansted, or it could be Gatwick. We actually argue that it start off with Gatwick because that's the most full. And then Gatwick came to us and said, can you be part of our advocacy team? So we joined with Gatwick and we did various things with them. And we developed ideas for their airport. And we called it networked connectivity, integrated connectivity, which is not our term. It was government advisors' terms. Integrated connectivity is what it's all. And we argued that Gatwick would do for the south of London, which needs desperately regenerating, not just Croydon, but through to Lewisham and across to Lambeth and Southwark. It would do for the south of London what the Olympics did for the east of London. But it would also do the same for all the south coast towns, which were all in need of regeneration. It's bigger than an extra runway. It's bigger than the business plan of air travel. I'm fascinated that we did this diagram a little while ago, that we've added an Edinburgh to London in the last 5 years. We're going to be adding a Birmingham in the next 10 years. And now, I've read the figures, we're actually, compared to 2010, we're going to be adding a Scotland by 2050. That's an extraordinary level of growth. And if you go back to the lecture I gave in 1984, that was the lowest point of around that time of London's population for 100 years. And there were still campaigns to move out of London. Location of offices bureau, the cap in the 70s on office building, anything more than 100,000 square feet you had to get permission for. And look at London now, look at Canary Wharf and all. And the government, God bless them, the mayor, and they identify opportunity areas and they persuade developers to go there. But actually, it needs bigger thinking. And I would say that one of the biggest thinking is the idea of a national park. I equate higher density with the national park. I think the two together will work. I think that we have the greenest metropolis of its kind. It is an exceptionally livable metropolis. And I think the big idea big ideas come up from others, whereas the mayors and planners, they just identify opportunity areas, and that's kind of that's useful, but it's bureaucracy. I look to intensify in the core. These are drawings we did for an article, but at the bottom, we said connect London with low-level bridges, and that was an idea that if you're going to expand East London, which has got a plan to have a population that is going to be an extra million, that's where the empty lands are, then you've got to start making extra bridges. And the bridges can't be high-level bridges, which are commuter bypass bridges. They ought to be low-level bridges, as they are in central London and west London. They've got to be spontaneous bridges. In other words, you can cycle across from side to side, you can walk, and you can visit your granny or go for a meet of friends in a pub. And it attracts people then to the banks. This I showed earlier. One of the schemes that we succeeded doing is the Euston Circus, where we looked at what the pattern of the movement was. It was all laid out, this picture on the left, it was all laid out in the line of the bus turning. And we did Regent's Place based upon that, which has got several crossings now across Euston Road. And architecture grew from it. And the other one I think is very interesting is the Home Office. If you look at the top picture there, the photograph, that is the Home Office, that was the Department of Environment, that we eventually knocked down. And the slide below it is the new Home Office. So the new Home Office has more square footage than the towers had. And it's actually got housing, it's got so many other things, it's got such diversity. But because the original one was on a podium, it's now completely different because you have routes going through. You have two main pedestrian routes going through it. And we worked on the urban design, both internally and externally, and we worked with art on the artists, and almost in a way, architecture became the lesser of them all, because the art and the urban design program took precedence. And there the routes through, and that's the art. We worked with Liam Gillick and 15 other artists. And so finally, thought leadership. I'm going to close very quickly. This is the Blueprint Awards for the work we did on the Farrell Review. And this is a diagram we did trying to, like we are trying to find the tangled bank patterns, we looked at the Treasury, we looked at the Treasury, the Home Office, and the Foreign Office, which all have been around for 100, 200 years. They've never been interfered with. Whereas the environment and housing and transport have shifted around forever. Only once in Heseltine's era was it all one department. And it is unbelievably fragmented. So when we were doing the review, we had about five or six departments to coordinate with. We did the review as sketches and diagrams. This is one of the features, which is one of the recommendations. Teach the built environment across all subjects in schools. We did PLACE as an acronym, planning, landscape, architecture, conservation, which could be interpreted other ways. It could be politics, law. I couldn't think of another one for architecture, but it could be construction or conservation. And E could be ecology. And we did feel very strongly that planning is not proactive. That's why the idea of the national park and city and so on is about proactive. And I think you should look at existing places, not just ones that are coming for planning consent. And urban room. These are urban rooms that have been opened recently. This is about a virtual urban room. And these are the champions and the way forward. And that's the Urban Design Alliance. I'll finish there.